decided to call my talk the last point from parsec problem because I want to emphasize what I think is very important. Well, the fact that this case, this point from parsec case, is really important if we want to understand the role that gaseous disks have in both respects. Both if we want, if we are interested in the role in driving the merger of two black holes, and if you're interested in understanding what kind of electromagnetic counterparts can come from a gaseous disk, as mentioned by Phil before. There are a number of collaborators over the years. Andrew and Phil are in the room, but I should mention also Sergey Action, Jim Pinkham and Ken Wright. So the first problem is how to shrink a black hole binary. So it's well known that stellar dynamical processes have a bottleneck upon parsec. And very often, gas dynamical processes are invoked in order to solve this problem, to overcome this this limit. However, as I'm going to discuss a bit more during the talk, the gas dynamical process too might have a bottleneck, a bit further down, not upon parsec, but maybe at a scale which is indeed 0.1 parsec. So we need really to understand that these dynamics at this scale, if we want to understand whether gas disk can allow the merger of a black hole binary. And I should mention that this region is really poorly understood, and it's actually quite crucial. So I think some effort should be placed in understanding the dynamics here, and I'm going to tell you why in a moment. Additionally, it's interesting that this scale, this particular scale, is actually intermediate between the scales which are simulated by two different communities, if you like. So on the one hand, we have those people who are interested in the small scale structure of the disk, and here I put a number of names who have studied this problem, and what these people are doing, including myself, is more related to the dynamics of standard accretion disks. The problem here is that 0.1 parsec is typically the outermost region that we simulate, that we consider in these studies, and that's where standard accretion disk models typically fail. So we have a problem here because this is our outermost region. On the other hand, those people, like for example Massimo, who should be around, who do galaxy scale studies, actually for them, 0.1 parsec is typically the inner boundary. And that's the region which is typically poorly resolved in their simulations. So none of us actually is treating very well this particular, this intermediate region. And the interesting thing is that we can actually learn from each other. There are processes that we do take into account in some cases, but they don't, and vice versa. For example, here I should mention a couple obvious things. On the small scales, we have now understood how important it is to really check what is the specific cooling that we have in our disk. The cooling time, the cooling rate is strongly affects the dynamics of the disk. And this has been fully appreciated in our case, but very often these large-scale studies often adopt polytropic, barotropic equational states. On the other hand, we typically ignore the role of the stellar component, which might be present, and it is actually this might be very important, and is usually instead taken into account in this other class of studies. So I guess that there is a lot of room for interaction between ourselves, and this is really important if we want to really understand this region. Now, what's the problem? There are actually two problems. One is the removal of the angular momentum. We have a black hole binary, the secondary has an angular momentum, and we need to remove the angular momentum from the secondary. Now, if we want to pick some number, let's say that the secondary has a mass of at least 10% of the primary, it can be larger, but let's say 10%. And we need to remove this angular momentum to allow it to move from 0.1 parsec down to 10 to the minus 3 parsec. That's the scale where gravitational wave emission takes over to drive the binary evolution. In some way, this problem of angular momentum removal is akin, is similar to the process, to the problem of black hole feeding around a single AGN from parsec scales, or 0.1 parsec scales. The other problem is the disk self-gravity. At this case, as I'm going to show, the disks are likely to be self-gravitating. And this might put severe constraints on the ability of the disk to allow the binary to shrink and go to smaller separations. Now, let's first consider the role of gas in removing the angular momentum of the binary. Here's a nice picture from Phil. The point is that the secondary, the column, and the disk can exchange angular momentum to tides. Now, these tides are actually really mediated by a number of resonances which sit close to the secondary orbit. And basically, in the regime that we're interested in, this leads to the formation of a gap. This is well studied for the case of planets and leads to what is called type 2 migration. But the point is that it's not just simply tides and resonances, because these allow the exchange of the angular momentum of the binary with the edges of the gap. Then what we need to do is to transport away this excess angular momentum from the gap edges in order for the gas to keep taking up this angular momentum and lead the migration all the way in. So that's why, in the end, the migration time from the secondary is related, but it's not equal to the viscous time in the disk. So typically, as this has been already shown by Andrew yesterday, the shrinking time, the time it takes for the secondary to migrate in, is related to the viscous time in the disk, but there is this proportionality factor here, and if we're here, Md is a measure of the local disk mass, so it's something like sigma a squared, where a is a separation. So if the disk mass is much smaller than the secondary mass, then this factor can be quite large. And this means that the shrinking time can be much longer than the viscous time in the disk. Now, what are these numbers? Let's take, again, some typical parameters. Let's take primary mass of 10 to the 6 solar masses. Let's be optimistic on the secondary, take it to be 0.1. It could be higher than that. If it's higher, then it's even worse. And for the disk, we might take this number, alpha, the Chaprusnik parameter. Let's take it to be 0.1. Here, again, we're optimistic. MHD calculations typically indicate rather smaller alpha. And let's take h upon r to be 5×10⁻³, that is typical for the aspect ratio in the disk at this scale. With these parameters, we get a viscous time at 0.1 parsec to be several 10 to the 8 years, which is already rather long. The next bit, if we want to understand, if we want to calculate the migration time, is to check what is the disk mass. Here there is a limit. If we want the disk to be gravitationally stable, we need to add the disk mass to be smaller than h upon r times the primary mass. That's in order to be gravitationally stable. And if you put the numbers in, it turns out that the shrinking time in this case is larger than 4×10⁻⁹ years, which is starting to become dangerously close to the age of the universe. So it's quite a long time. And this clearly shows that if we want this gaseous disk to be able to help us in bringing the binary down, we need to have disks which are fairly massive, which are actually in the regime where the mass is at least of the order of h upon r times the primary. So basically what we know is that if these disks are needed to bring the binary down, they need to be self-gravitating. They need to be subject to gravitational instability. And we need to study then what is the dynamics of self-gravitating disks. Now, luckily, in the last 10 years or so, we have studied the dynamics of gravitationally unstable disks. And we now know a lot more than we used to, but we don't know everything. I'm going to tell you first what we do know. Well, we've been studying for a long time this problem. And there's one thing that we have always known, that is the linear stability is determined by this Q parameter. Basically, the requirement to be stable, linearly stable, is, according to this criterion, is equivalent to requiring that the disk mass is of the order of h upon r times the primary. What is new, what has been understood recently, is that the nonlinear evolution is determined by a different parameter, which is the ratio between the cooling time and the dynamical time in the disk. I call this number beta. And basically, what happens is that if beta is larger than a critical value, which is of the order of unity, then this instability, this linear instability, grows but saturates at a finite amplitude without running away. And basically, what happens in this case, this is a typical simulation in this regime, is that we do produce a spiral structure, but the amplitude of the spiral structure is finite. It doesn't lead to fragmentation. And this disk can go on for several thermal timescales, and its only evolution will be on the secular viscous evolution of the disk. So basically, here, apart from the development of the spiral structure, nothing special happens. On the other case, if beta is less than this critical number, then we have a runaway growth of the instability, and the disk, rather than displaying this nice spiral structure, fragments into a number of gravitationally bound objects, which we might call stars.
Sorry, what is the difference in beta between the two situations?
Basically, there is a threshold which is, with it depends a little bit on who makes the simulation, whether it's 2D or 3D, on the ratio of specifically in the disk. But beta crit sits around 4.
Yeah. But about those two simulations there?
What those specific two. Yeah. This one is of order 10, this one is of order 3. There are actually numerical constraints. We can't explore a very wide range of beta.
But 3 is over 1.
I said beta crit of order 1, it's a number of order 1. The actual threshold, as I mentioned, is around 4 or 5.
Okay.
It's a number of order 1. No, it's not 10. So this beta crit, as I mentioned, it does depend if we do the simulation in 2D or in 3D. So anyway, so we have or don't have fragmentation depending on the cooling time. Now, what is the typical cooling time in this 0.1 parsec? It turns out that if you calculate beta in the gene, this is much less than that. It's of order of 10 to the minus 2 at least. This would mean that in this case, we should have fragmentation. However, what we really don't know is what is the evolution of the disk once fragmentation takes place. What is the evolution of this fragmenting disk? I should mention that this cooling time here is the thermal cooling time, okay? If the disk is supported by thermal pressure. Now, one question is that whether fragmentation leads to star formation, or rather leads to the formation of a number of clumps, which are then supported by turbulent pressure, more or less what happens in local star-forming clouds, which are genes unstable, but they're supported by turbulence. Now, if turbulence dominates, the cooling time is actually the decay time of the turbulence, which corresponds to beta, which might be close to 1. So we are if this happens, then we are really close to the threshold between fragmenting and non-fragmenting disk. So it's not obvious what happens in this regime if the disk is turbulent and turbulence is dominating. A related question is how much mass is turning to stars once fragmentation is in place. One might possibly say, this is what we have argued in this paper, is that we turn just enough mass into stars in order to provide a required heating to keep the disk marginally stable. So we can calculate the cooling rate and just say we turn enough gas into stars so as to balance the cooling rate. This will also depend exactly on what's the value of beta. Another important thing that we don't know for the evolution of this self-gravitating disk is how much angular momentum transport is determined by these processes. In a purely gaseous disk, we can calculate the stresses provided by the spiral structure, and we have done that. And it turns out that we give an equivalent stress, which if we measure that in terms of alpha, it turns out to be of order 0.05 or so. However, this refers to a purely gaseous environment. Recently, Hopkins and Quatert have argued that if the gas, if we don't have just gas, but we have a mixture of gas and stars, then the angular momentum transport can be much more efficient. A related question, here I put a question mark, is whether these instabilities lead to the formation of bars or bars within bars, as often mentioned. Here again, I should say, purely gaseous simulation often don't show bars. We might have a large scale n equal 2 perturbance, but generally we don't see the development of strong bars. Whether this is the case also in the presence of stars, that's a completely different question. Now, having said all that, what can we do? What have we done? Here I refer to some calculations that we have done in this paper. We have run a number of very simple time-dependent models of a binary black hole surrounded by a gaseous disk with a finite mass. Basically, what we have solved is a standard migration problem, as it is often done in the field of planetary studies. We solved the standard viscous evolution for the surface density in the disk, including the tidal torques from the binary, and then we also evolved the binary orbit according to the same torques, so the angular momentum is conserved. But we have run two different sets of simulation. In some cases, we have not considered the effect of fragmentation, so even if the disk was going to be gravitationally stable, unstable, we just forgot about it, and we let it go without fragmentation. And then we have run another set of simulations where we do take into account fragmentation according to this prescription. These are the numbers that we, the system parameters that we simulate. And here I'm going to show you some results of this kind of calculations. This, what is shown here is the evolution of the binary separation as a function of time in a number of different sets. So here, we start the simulation with a separation of 0.01 parsecs. So we are already quite close in. The gravitational wave time at this stage is 10 to the 8 years, and the viscous time is rather short at 0.01 parsec. And here we see these two lines. One refers to the migration without star formation, so we just allow the disk to be gravitationally stable and forget about it. And here, instead, we take into account star formation and we turn fraction of the gas into stars. What is seen is that, in general, the effect of removing gas mass is to slow down migration by a factor of at least a factor of 10. But in this particular case, if we start from 0.01 parsec, still the merger occurs. So it occurs quite fast in this without star formation. With star formation, it takes a little bit longer, but within 10 mega years, it does manage to get to the regime where gravitational wave dominates. So starting from this separation is not a problem, even with star formation. The things change completely if we instead start a bit farther out. Here we have started at 0.05 parsecs. And here the situation is very different. Without star formation, we do manage to get the merger going. With star formation, this is strongly self-gravitating at this stage, so a lot of mass needs to be turned into stars, and essentially there is almost no evolution at all for the binary separation. So in this case, the merger would fail if it's purely driven by the gas. Okay, so it's important to understand whether the disk fragments or not, because from this 0.1 parsec scale actually might affect our the merger occurring or not.
You consider the interaction between the newly formed stars and the binary?
No, exactly. No, we haven't. I'm going to mention that at the end. That's a very important point, but in this case we haven't. There is a number of byproducts that we can obtain by these simulations. In particular, we can study what is the structure of the disk at decoupling. These are the radius where gravitational waves take over for the evolution. Here are a number of properties of the disk. The different lines refer to different disk masses. Here is shown the surface density, mass flux through the disk, h upon r, and effective temperature. There are a number of things to notice. First of all, is that in most of our simulation, there is a low-density circumprimary disk at decoupling. That's actually quite important because, as mentioned by Phil a moment ago, once gravitational waves shrink the binary further down, the presence of this low-density gas there can provide a visible signature in terms of a strong enhancement of the luminosity, which we have plotted here. So if there is this circumprimary disk, then this can lead to a counterpart straight at the moment of the merger. A second thing which is important, which has been mentioned before by Andrew, is that the mass flux to the disk is not constant. So these simulations rather do evolve to a quasi-steady state, but this is not an accretion disk with a constant m dot. It's not a steady accretion disk. It's rather a steady decretion disk, where m dot decreases with radius as up to the minus a half. And this has implications for the ACD of these disks. A third thing that I would like you to notice is these small spikes here at the edges of the gap. This is the effect of the heating the tidal heating that is due to the dissipation of non-circular motion close to the gap edges as the resonances produce spiral waves at the gap edges. This is actually quite interesting because they can provide a high energy emission at radii which would normally be much cooler. Now, what's then the shape of an SED of a typical disk at decoupling? Now, I wanted to focus on this bottom panel here. That's a typical multicore blackbody disk SED. And the red line is the SED which would be predicted by Milosavljevic and Finney, who have simply assumed that the disk was a standard accretion disk truncated at the decoupling radius. So here's a standard SED of a disk truncated at the decoupling radius. Now, it turns out that actually this is not exactly like that. It's slightly different for the reasons that I mentioned before. First of all, the disk is a decretion disk, not an accretion disk. This leads to a different shape of the SED in this part, so it's slightly steeper than an accretion disk. The second important effect is the fact that there are these hot inner edges, which provide a high energy contribution to the SED, which is absent in a pure truncated disk. This is important because one of the effects that Phil mentioned is that after the merger, we can see the refilling of the inner disk and therefore the rebrightening of an AGN. Now, these high energy components might already be present before due to these hot edges emission. So this effect might be partially offset by the presence of these hot edges emission. So here I summarize what I've already said. I should just mention another important thing that is related to this emission from the edges. As I mentioned, we have a high energy spectral component, which is typical of an inner disk, because the temperatures are typical of an inner disk, but which is occurring at a rather large radius. So if there is some variability due to, say, for example, a slight eccentricity that might be excited during the evolution, now we would see this high energy spectral component, which is varying on a rather long time scale with respect to what we would expect if we associated this component to the inner disk. So this might be a signature of the presence of a binary well before the merger takes place. And finally, as I mentioned, the inner low density disk would provide a super electron flare during the actual final quiescence. Let me just then summarize what I think about the last point of parsec problem. I think there is a problem. So the last point of parsec problem is generally not solved by gas disk, because there is the possibility of fragmentation due to self-gravity. Coalescence occurs within, of course, even in the presence of fragmentation, only if the separation is initially already rather small, at least of order 0.01 parsec. But as I mentioned, there are several uncertainties. First of all, we really do not understand the behavior of self-gravity in this at that scale. So I think there's a lot of work to be done in this regime. Especially, what is the star formation rate in these gravitationally unstable disks? And then, as was mentioned before, it's interesting to take into account what is the interaction between the newly born stars and the binary, which hasn't been taken into account in the simulation that I just showed. And I think I'll just stop.
Very good. Left some room for questions.
Yes. How do you expect the magnetic field will contribute to gravitation?
It's an interesting question. Not very many studies have been done in this regime. There are a couple of simulations by Fomang about the interaction of gravitational instabilities and MHD instabilities. In general, the effect would be to lessen the effect of gravitational instability, because they would provide an extra heating source to the disk, which would ameliorate the gravitational instability. So in general, I would expect a slightly smaller effect, although we really do not really know how would the nonlinear coupling become more than gravitational multiple.
So in the last simulation you were mentioning, this is a 1D.
This is just a 1D.
And what are the masses in the innermost disk that you were?
You're showing the circumprimary disk. Yeah. Well, this depends on This depends on the initial mass that we, as I mentioned, this simulation starts with the finite disk mass. So we have a total amount of mass in the disk. And here, okay, actually I wouldn't know the numbers straight ahead. It does depend. This simulation has a number of three different disk masses. I can check later. You know, you can see the sigma and R, one can work it out, but I actually don't know the numbers now. Sorry? No, that's the total disk mass. That's not
the amount that's
there. I think the question was about how much
many
is left in the
there.
Okay, no, not what is written there is the initial total disk mass.
Did you want?
Could you explain why you expect cooling times as short as only comparable to the orbital period? And generically, in steady state accretion disks, the cooling time is sort of an order of magnitude longer than the orbital period. And I would expect that with the buildup of mass near the inner edge, the cooling time would be even greater.
Well, it does depend on where you are in the disk. If you take conditions at 0.1 parsec, typically the cooling time there is actually quite...
What do you assume about the runner surface density? Because I said if it were a characteristic of a steady state accretion flow, sort of built in by the process, that the cooling time is kind of, you know, 1/alpha times 1/omega.
Okay. In general, even steady state models, independently on the presence or not of a binary, show that basically. You can check Goodman, for example, 2003, and there you see that the amount of heat that you can get at 0.1 parsec from viscous evolution of the disk is actually much less than what you obtain by cooling a self-gravitated disk. If you require Q to be over the one, if you have this a lot of mass at 0.1 parsec, and check the temperature that it needs to have in order to be gravitationally stable, so Q equal 1, then the cooling time is much larger than the heating that you get viscously. So unless basically a standard steady state model as you are thinking of would lead to a much smaller value of Q in this regime. If you extrapolate a Shakur-Sunyaev parameter, Shakur-Sunyaev model at 1 parsec, then the expected Q is a tiny number. If you insist that Q is of order 1, then the cooling rate is much higher.
Okay, so the point is that the process of local gravitational stability itself generates the heat.
Yes.
Okay, one very quick one from Christian. And we'll have coffee.
Andrew and you, Giuseppe, put forward this notion that aggression instability is a problem in the context of this binary mergers. And I think that's very fair. We just don't know how to deal with this at one point. People have considered the possibility that you would actually form stars and feed back some energy, and you could build a structure that way. And so, if that were to happen, then it seems to me there is a route there for efficient mergers still, because you form stars, and to the extent that the stars can migrate, Titan migrate like small planets do in protoplanetary disks, and the time scale shorter than their evolutionary time scale, they would reach the binary. And then you can, in principle, tap angular momentum and energy and eject
from the start.
Do you consider this?
As I mentioned in the last slide, no. It's actually very important to study the interaction of the newly born stars with the binary. Still, it's not obvious to me.
It's a tendency for probably the stars to move in
and
reach the binary.
And but I actually don't know how much you make the calculation, but there you will be very close to correlation with the binary. So it's not obvious how much angular momentum can you take out in this way. So it could be, but it's not obvious.
I'm going to stop it there. It sounds like this discussion is going to continue. But thank you.